PRs that need to be done. Tons and tons and tons of work. Part 3, Air Force Stories, Lieutenant Colonel Nutnfancy. Thanks, guys, for coming along with the ride, listening to my stories, perhaps, I don't know, learning a few life lessons along the way. I was talking about don't be a CS. Chicken shit. Don't be one of those guys, man. You know, I ran into it a lot with my crews that I'd be paired with. We're over in, I think, Germany. We're taking off on this particular sortie. We were tagged to refuel some C-17s that were on a priority mission. I think they're carrying some special ops teams over to theater. And we were supposed to just do a real short mission, take off, offload a bunch of fuel, you know, like 70, 90,000 pounds of gas, whatever it was. I have to look at my logbook. And then land. And it was a big deal because it would save those guys time. They had to get in theater very quickly. We're looking at the end of the runway, and we see a big old thunderstorm. It's like black. It's like just horrible. And my crew's behind me like, we're canceling. I'm like, oh. Let me give you this information. This is important, especially for you pilots out there. The thunderstorm was about 2 miles off the end of the runway. It was not on field. And so there was a way you could take off, and our regulations at the time still say it. You don't fly through thunderstorms. That's a given. I mean, you'll destroy your aircraft or die or both, probably both. Take off, and I was like, you know what? We couldn't take off the opposite direction because the winds gave us too big of a tailwind. There's no way we could do that. So we had to take off into the wind. I was like, you know what, guys? Let's take off, and we'll crank it. We're not going in there. We'll just do a hard right turn, and let's go get this mission done. Pretty much everybody on the crew is like, no, let's cancel. What? Pansies. Yeah, they wanted to cancel. Nav wanted to cancel. Co-pilot wanted to cancel. I think the boom was ambivalent. Like, I don't care either way. You know, I'm Poland. I'm not like a Hitler. I'm like, what do you guys think? We need to go get this guy. I'm like, no. And I overrode him. I was like, we're going. Don't be a chicken shit, man. We're going. Yeah, it looks scary off to him, but I can do it safely. I know I can do it safely. Sure enough, we took off, cranked it immediately after takeoff. The cell came over the field, and we just barely escaped it. Not barely, by 2 miles. That's actually not that close. Did the mission. It turned out great. By the time we landed, the thunderstorm was off the field, and I was like, told ya! It's an operational mission, guys. This isn't a training mission. These guys are counting on us, okay? I don't want to be that tanker like, oh, the guy canceled again. Why? Well, his crosswinds were too high. He had bad weather. He had a mechanical. I remember reading Robert S. Johnson's book, Thunderbolt. He was a P-47 Thunderbolt pilot in World War II. I told you I read this stuff growing up. Studied it, actually. And he always used to say they'd take off the P-47s. They'd go into the ETO, European Theater of Operations. He was a super stud, by the way. He was an ace several times over, actually, Robert S. Johnson. And he's like, every time they're going to the target, they'd have, I don't know, 16 P-47s. There would be some that just turn back on manufactured reasons. Oh, yeah, guys, I got to turn back. I got, you know, a little oil pressure. They land. Mechanic looks at it. There's nothing wrong with this plane. They're just making up reasons because they're scared. Now, I'm not going to say that I'm not going to condemn those people, but I'm just saying that's out there. There's people who are, you know, if you were to crank out the percentages, there's probably 80% that are just kind of there. There's another 20% that are really there. They're swinging. Maybe the percentages are less. They're true warriors. They're getting the job done. And that's always how I wanted to approach my job in the U.S. Air Force, is I would, you know, shuck all the jive, bring home the love, the important stuff, the mission, getting the gas, getting the cargo there. I'm not dropping bombs. I'm not strafing. It's not that glamorous, but I want to be good at it. I want to be reliable. I want them to say, hey, you know what? That Utah Air National Guard unit, those guys kick ass because they were there when we needed them. And everybody else bailed out on us, but they were there. Or my active duty unit, they were there. You know, I take pride in my military unit. I want them to have an awesome reputation of excellence. Kind of like the Pappy Boynton mentality. That's kind of how I am, that I just, you know, the other nonsense. I'm not saying I'm a total slacker, military courtesy, but, you know, I see dude a lot. I said dude a lot back then. You know, I remember one time we're deployed over in Turkey. The comma is so funny. Bucket Nester's with me. You didn't know Bucket Nester was in the Air Force, did you? Yeah, he's one of my crew members, dudes. Boom operator. Bucket's one of my boom operators. Has been for years. Great friend. Still to this day. You see Bucket Nester all the time. So Bug and Esther's with me. We go cranking in that. I have this music playing, man. And we are in charge of this mission planning facility. It's like some really serious LC, Lieutenant Colonel. He's with the C-17s. You know, they're in charge over there at the time. It's Enserlik. We roll in. I'm playing my music. I'm having a good time with my crew. And I could see immediate displeasure on his face. Like, you know, like, you shouldn't be doing that. He didn't say nothing to me because I'm equal rank. I'm like, suck it. Awesome. I loved it when I made LC. I couldn't believe I made LC. I tell you what, I didn't make LC on political correctness. I wasn't an administrative IP. I made it because I had a warrior record. All the stuff I'm telling you is in my military record. And the Air Force, I will have to say, does do that. At least they did. I didn't even do ACSC, Air Command and Staff College. I'm like, I'm not doing that. That's stupid. Laughing. Yeah, I made LC without ACSC. Whatever. You know, but that's me. I mean, there's important stuff and there's stuff that's nonsense. I'm going to talk more about that. Shuck the nonsense. Walk into this guy. He's all pissed off. You know, I can tell he's pissed. And we still keep cranking our music. Why did I do that? Well, it's because I want my crew to have fun. I want it to be fun. They're away from their families for months and months on end. Why not make it awesome? And that will lead into the next point. And I'm going to come back to don't be a CS, but have fun when you're in the U.S. military. I did. I'm known for that, too. Really off-the-wall sense of humor. I'll roll in this picture. I mean, this is me just goofing around with my guys. I have these stupid teeth in. Oh, my gosh. I had so much fun with those teeth. Have fun, man. Be off the wall. Make memories for your guys. You know, if you're a leader, I was the aircraft commander, instructor pilot on that crew. I want it to be memorable. And to this day, they say, man, that was one of the funnest deployments I went on. You know, taking into consideration the circumstances we're in. It was fun. Here's another one. Over deployed over in Southwest Asia somewhere. I'm not going to tell you where. And we're attached to some Navy planes at this time. I think there were some A-6s. So we were hitting them. They were enforcing one of the no-fly zones over there. So it was a long mission. We were just staying up there, giving them gas so they could stay airborne so they wouldn't have to go all the way back to their field and land. So we hit them. Between refuelings, we had time. We had probably an hour. So we're up there just drilling holes in the sky. I looked down below us, and there's a bunch, you know, Navy ships down there. Big old carrier down there. I'm like, oh, that's cool. Got an hour. I think it's time to go make a memory. Not be stupid. Make a memory. And so I got on the horn. I looked in all our paperwork, found the frequency for that carrier, found the name of it, found the controller, and then we contact them. We say, hey, listen, this is such and such. We're airborne overhead. We'd like to come down and do an approach to the carrier, KC-135 style. They're like, yeah, rock on, dudes. We'd love that. So we're actually talking to the carrier, the tower of the aircraft carrier. I brief it up, though. Remember my point I said is weigh risk, manage risk. So you just don't go, let's go down. Then you do something stupid and you kill everybody on board. You don't want to do that. So I'm like, okay, guys, here's what we're going to do. We're going to do an approach to the carrier. Maybe we'll do a flyby. My first preference is an approach under tower control. We'll climb back up to refueling. We'll get permission from our airborne asset because they're controlling us. Say, hey, listen, we're going to do this. We're not going to tell them what we're doing. I mean, we're not stupid. We're going to say, hey, we just need to drop down off your radar for a little while for training. That's all we said. They're like, rock on, let's go do it. Had an ultra cool co-pilot at the time, Russ. He was awesome. Cool nav. So we go down, good way. And then we get down. It's kind of not foggy, but it's just misty down there. We see some battleships, some cruisers. I'm down really low. We're talking to towers like, yeah, we're going to come up from the stern position. Here I am going all over my naval term. Starboard's right, correct? Talking to crew because that's how they talk. Yeah, come up, you know, stern, up stern. I'm like, okay, cool. And then the carrier tower goes, hey, sorry, we can't take your approach. But I'll tell you what, you are cleared through the pattern. Because they do have a pattern with the aircraft carrier. It's like, go ahead and give us a flyby. I'm like, rock on. Came up, you know, side of the carrier. And I told Russ, who had a camera, I was like, dude, you totally got to get me some pictures. He's like, oh, don't worry. Don't worry. He's like, oh, okay, don't screw it up, Russ. So I'm flying, and I'm being really careful because we're close to the water. Big old plane. Okay, again, manage risk. Don't be stupid. So I'm really concentrating. Thinking, okay, I briefed the crew up. This is what we're going to do, guys. We're going to come on, you know, this side of the carrier. And we see there's everybody standing on this carrier. They're all like, yeah. They're like cheering. And we come up speed of heat. I mean, I am cooking. I wish I had this it's on video for you guys. So wish it was the most sweetest flyby. Level with the carrier. Here it comes, ripping. Everyone's like, I mean, I didn't see this, but Russ did because he's telling me. Everyone's like, yeah, pull up vertical. Not vertical. 60 degree pull up, which is a lot for a tanker. Again, you don't want to be stupid. You don't want to wreck the plane. Nice, easy pull up, easy G's. Level back up. Pull the motors back. I'm like, that rocked. Tower comes over. I was like, dude, that was sweet. That was the coolest flyby we've ever seen. Thanks much, man. We sure appreciate it. Really cool. He's like, thanks for all the refueling you give us and for always being there and being on the spot and being dependable. Our squadron was tasked to them at that time. We were doing a bunch of Navy refueling. So like, and I was like, you rock, man. No problem. We love being there with you. And I turned to Russ like, dude, you got the picture, right? He's like, oh, I forgot. I'm like, Russ, dude. Oh, I can never do that again. I would have had pictures of that. Oh, that would have been a sweet, sweet picture. Who knows? There's probably some pictures floating around there of a KC-135. A beam, the carrier. That was probably me, maybe. I don't know. Maybe not. You know, maybe I'm just making it up. Yeah, that's right. Climbed up, talked to our airborne asset, back on station. Have fun. To this day, that's a fun memory for those guys. All my crew, every time I've seen them when I was in the military, they're like, man, that was fun. I'm so glad we did that. Have fun. Make it fun. Make it memorable. Here's another story. You guys digging this? I don't know if you are or not. I think you are. I think you are. Because I told you it's very forthcoming. It's very honest. And it's fun. Okay, so we are... Another Air Force story. We're over in England on another European tanker task force. And we're actually tasked with Belgian F-16s. Let me tell you about the Belgians, by the way. There's not too many F-16 drivers out there that can actually stand head-to-head, toe-to-toe with an American, highly trained F-16 pilot who's good. I'm talking air-to-air. The Belgians can. The Belgians are pretty darn good. I know this because I've got lots of fighter buddies. They tell me this. They fought against all kinds of nationalities, and they're like, the Belgians are pretty much good. They don't back down. They're not scared. They know how to employ the weapon system. They know how to manage their energy. They're good. So the Belgians were a crack up. And at the time, this is earlier, not this deployment, but on an earlier deployment, I had a really good looking female boom operator, had long hair, built, just saying. And so she would lay down in the boom pod and her hair, she's so funny, Tina was her name. She's actually a New Hampshire Highway Patroller, I think, last time I checked in with her. Awesome gal, love her, we're great friends. And she'd be back there refueling, and these Belgian guys would come up there like, huh? And they would immediately go into showing off for Tina, man. They'd be back there. She's like, you cannot believe these guys. One guy's flying upside down. So he comes off the boom, not being unsafe. So they get their gas. They come off the boom, which actually is a controlled device, which they fly into the receptacle, the nozzle of the aircraft. They transfer fuel that way. That's what the boom operator's job is. He's flying that down to that position. Transferring gas. Belgian F-16 would back out. He'd go into observation position, you know, back behind, and then he just starts showing off. He's like flying upside down. Why? Because Tina's there. Trying to impress her. Go do an afterburner show. She's like, these guys are just crazy. Anyways, back to the original story. So we're tasked to Belgian F-16s. We refueled them, and at the time, they told us out of England, hey, dudes, the Air Force is telling us, actually is USAFE. Which is European Command of the Air Force. They're like, hey guys, don't do any bootleg ARs, air refuelings, because we've refueled foreign receivers. We don't have their contact information. We don't have their tail numbers. We never get the money for basically what amounts to $300,000, $400,000 worth of gas. Yeah, it's a big deal. No bootleg ARs. If the guy's not on your sheet, you know he's coming, he's scheduled, he's fragged, as we call it, don't do them. Everyone's like, you got it, no bootleg ARs. So we're up there. Drilling area, I think we're in Erica track. I look below us, and the F-16s have cleared off, and here comes another KC-135. And they're like 4,000 feet below us. I'm like, check this dude out. That's one of our squadron buddies. He's drilling holes. His receivers clear off. So now it's just us two waiting for the fighters to come back from their exercises, maneuvers, whatever the crap they're doing. And then we'll refuel them again, and then we'll go back home. So we have time. We know for a fact our receivers aren't returning for a long time. So I was like, hey, you guys want to have a good time with this dude? And he's like, yeah. And we knew who this pilot was. He was a CS pilot. I'm just saying. He was horrible. Bad pilot. Wouldn't admit fault. Incompetent. Sorry. He was. I was like, hey, let's have fun with him. Here's what we're going to do, guys. We're going to pretend like we are a German F4, actually a four ship of German F4s checking on, requesting a bootleg refueling. And let's see if he gives us gas. Let's practice. So we all get our helmets on, and the KC-135, the crews travel with their helmets in case you ever have to bail out, because at the time we had parachutes on board, helmets. So everybody gets on helmet. And when you talk on helmet, you know, it's obviously very different. It's like stuff you've heard in the movies. So I was like, okay, let's practice our check on so we sound authentic. So I get my German accent and I'm like,
strike a flight check.
You know, and the co-pilot goes, two. And the nav goes, two. And then we had a Texas boom operator. Slim was his name. Great guy. Love Slim. And he goes, four. And I'm like, dude, okay, you cannot say it that way because we got to sound like we're German. Yeah, our accents are bad, but we got to fool this guy. And I'm like, okay, so we practice. We get on the refueling frequency of the aircraft behind us. And it's, while we're talking, I maneuvered my tanker to be above and behind him. So he can't see me. So I drop down. We got permission from control to drop down. So actually, no, we had the whole airspace. So we could do whatever we want. So I drop down like, you know, 2,000 feet above him. And I'm just following him. So when he turns, I turn. So if he was to look out his window, he would see nobody. And I'm high enough that the boom, if he went back in the boom pod looking around, he wouldn't see me. Here we come. We're on the frequency. And I'm like,
strike a flight check. Two, three, four.
I'm like, three. Slim still got the Texas accent thing going. I thought for sure we'd be busted. And I goes like,
yes, Blue 42, this is strike a flight. Request a refueling. We are at your 6 o'clock position.
I know it's a stupid accent. So the tanker in front of us goes, he's like Blue 42. I guess that was the call sign. He goes, yeah, striker flight, say your position.
Yeah, we're at your 6 o'clock position.
I sound like Arnold Schwarzenegger. Bump you up. And he goes, yeah, throw an air-to-air attack in channel 53 or 63, whatever it was. And I repeated it like back wrong.
Roger, we're throwing in channel 64.
Negative, it's 63. And I'm like,
oh, Roger, 65.
Negative, and we're just stressing these guys out. They're throwing papers around. They're trying to look. Where's striker flight? We don't see him. You know, I was like, oh, say position again.
Yeah, we're at your high 6 o'clock position. Yeah, ready? Requesting refueling, over.
And these guys go, Roger, you're cleared in. What? Idiots. They're specifically told no bootleg refuelings, and they honestly believe they're talking to a four ship of German F4s, which, by the way, they were flying at the time. F4s, cool plane. So funny. And they go, so they don't even see these guys. They're not establishing visual contact, and they clear these guys in. My crew in the behind me is rolling. They are laughing so hard. And I'm just, you know, the lead German F4 talking is like, and they go, hey, yeah, see your call sign again. And I come across, and it's time to let them know they've been had. And I go,
yeah, our call sign is Blue 43.
At that time, I peeled off from the guy. He's right here, and I peel. He's in a turn. I turn inside of him and pull ahead of him, and you can see he's been had. It's another KC-135. Totally got those guys. They landed, and they're all... The aircraft commander, that one guy, was all upset. He's like, oh, that wasn't funny. I mean, I was like, yeah, it was. It was hilarious. You got had, man. Idiot. Clearing in a bootleg air refueling. They told you not to do that. Have fun, man. That's all I'm trying to do is have fun, make memories with my crew, and now I can share them with you. Have fun. Talked about don't be a CS. And part of that, I want to go back to that, is... Stand up for your people. I gave you that story about be loyal to your squadron mates and also to your leadership. When you have a good leader, be loyal to him or her. They deserve it, you know, and back them up. They don't have to be perfect. As long as they're doing basically the right thing, they deserve your loyalty. Stand up for them. And I had some really, really good examples as leaders in the U.S. Air Force during my career. One of them was Bob Keneally. I'm just going to say his full name because I want him to get full credit. The best squadron commander I think I ever had. Because at the time, my wife had some health issues. We lost a child. I'll tell you about that in a separate video. It was very sad. It was very tough. And Lieutenant Colonel Keneally was right there by us at the hospital. He cared for his people. And I really, really think that's an important part of being a good leader. Yes, you balance mission with people. You have to be good at that. You can't be all people and go, because then you can't get the mission. You got a machine gun nest over there. I can't charge it because I don't want anybody to die. You got to get the job done. You got to do it. Someone's got to go. So you have to make those hard calls, and that's part of being a good leader, is making those hard calls. But also know your people, care for your people. He was excellent. Bob Keneally. And here's one of the things he really did that I really admired about him, is he would stand up for his people. Even though it probably meant he would get punished in his career. He was not a careerist. Okay, going back to CS, I think careerists are CS. Sorry. That you only do things to punch your ticket, to be an instructor pilot, to be an aircraft commander, to be a flight lead. You're not very good at it. You don't really want to do it, but you really want to get this rank or 06 or higher, and you're just punching your card, and you're stepping along people along the way. You're using your subordinates as stepping stones. I mean, I had another squadron commander there that did that at Fairchild. I mean, he was a real go-getter, like, we're going to go to go. He's always volunteering our squadron for every deployment that came down, even though we had just come back from a deployment. Everybody was pissed off. It's like, we just came back. Can't you go to wing stand up? At the time, there were 5 squadrons at Fairchild. And say, you know what? We need some downtime. He never would. He'd raise his hands like, yeah, my guys are ready. We'll go. Why? Because he wanted to make rank. He wanted to be their go-to fella on the backs of his subordinates who, you know, didn't see their families for 6 months. Yeah, it pisses people off. You know, when you're a guy like me that, you know, you do your fair share of deploying, you get bitching rights. And that's all I really look for. You know, part of being a non-chicken shit is do your fair share. You don't have to be a hero. But when it's time to step up, step up. You know, there's guys that are in my squadron that would do everything in their power not to do their fair share. Okay, they're trying to get out of deployment. So, oh man, I got this going on. Now I've got this drama going on. My wife will leave me. My wife's going to divorce me if I get on this deployment. I had a female safety officer over there. She started crying out with my squadron commander. She's like, oh, I can't do this. She's over deployed there in the Mideast. She goes, I can't do this. You know, I got to go home. I got so many things waiting for me. And the squadron commander, she goes, which I'm sorry, at the time was female. She goes, okay, no problem. We'll go ahead and pull you on home. My phone rings. They're like, hey, nothing fancy. Pack your bags. You're going 3 weeks early over there. What? I went over 3 weeks early to spell her out. Yeah, it was pretty jacked up. But my card's full up because I have so much video time. So I'm going to swap the card out and then I'll continue the story here in just a sec. Okay, new card in. Where was I? I'll try to get to my train of thought again. I think I was talking about Bob Keneally. What an awesome squadron commander, and actually what a great friend he was to his subordinates. I was a captain at the time. Coming out to the hospital with Mrs. Nutnfancy, myself, spending time. He truly, truly cared about his people. He was a good leader, too. He cared about the mission, about the safety, about leaning forward when it was appropriate to lean forward, to be a warrior when it was appropriate to be a warrior. He was all that. Great pilot, by the way. Good flyer, which I think every squadron commander should be. Should be able to look up to him. He'd be like a company commander. The guy should be a good warrior. Should be good at his job to get the respect of his subordinates. I can't tell you how many times I saw where that wasn't the case, that the leader was actually quite incompetent at their primary job, and that is being a combat-capable pilot. I don't respect people like that. A lot of people, most people don't. And everyone knows it. You're not hiding from it. Your reputation will precede you. You will build your reputation. People will know about you before you even come. You know, that guy's squared away. That guy sucks. That guy's a careerist. That guy's a warrior. He's a good dude. Gets it done. He pulls his weight. He doesn't try to duck out of deployments. I was talking about that, too. Bitching rights because I pulled my weight. Just pull your fair share. Pull your weight. And there's squadron commanders that get that. They're like, hey, we'll pull our fair share. Maybe a little bit more than our fair share if it's appropriate. You know, there's some other extenuating circumstances for that squadron of what's going on. Yeah, maybe it's appropriate that you ask your guys, hey, this is what's going on in their squadron. Are you guys cool if we step in and take this deployment from them? I bet you your people will be on board then if you explain and give them a little bit of say in the process, since it's their personal lives that are going to take a hit. They're the ones going to be taking the sacrifice. Bob Keneally got it. He was that type of leader. We came back from a long deployment in the Mideast. He goes to wing stand-up. And by the way, wing stand-up is when you're in front of the wing commander. All the squadron commanders are there. The ops officers, the wing execs there, whatever, whoever the crap those people are. And they're discussing, you know, the deployments, what's going on, and they're also doling out assignments because down from top, you know, what was it, 15th Air Force, down comes the assignment, and they go, hey, we need You know, we need 8 jets and 15 crews, whatever it is, the ratio was at the time, to go on this deployment. And they came to Bob Keneally and they said, hey, Lieutenant Colonel Keneally, here you go. We want you to do this. And he just basically stood up and wing stand up. I know this to be a fact because I had one of my buddies there and he saw this and he reported it to me. He's like, Bob stood up and he goes, you know what? I don't think we're going to be able to support that. Now, here's the thing about Bob is that he wasn't just standing up and falling on his sword in front of the 06, the full bird colonel, and saying, no, I'm just not going to do it. Because that's not doable in the military. Air Force, whatever military. You don't do it that way. You don't go, oh, I'm not going to obey that order. You don't. It's an order. You do it. He gamed it. He goes, you know what? I don't think we're going to be able to support that because I have most of my crews going into non-mission ready status. Awesome. What that meant is that we had these training events that had to be accomplished. When we're deployed over in the desert, we couldn't do them. We couldn't do all our training events because touch and goes weren't authorized at the fields we were deployed at. It was too operationally busy anyhow. We couldn't do our heavy autopilot off refueling. All the other things that we had to do for currency to be current and qualified in the aircraft and the MWS, we couldn't do. And that's the card he pulled out. And he was so smart. Because what do you say to that? Because now if your air crew is going non-mission ready as a Wing 06, you can't go, well, I want you to go even though your crews are unqualified. You can't say that. You know, IG wouldn't, the Inspector General wouldn't allow that. They said, no, that's BS. You can't do that. That's what Bob did. He's like, yeah, we're going to go non-mission ready if we don't have some downtime so we can catch up with training. Score one for Bob. So the Wing 06 goes, good call. Hey, 96, you're going. So awesome. He got huge points with all of us because he made the right call. Because we'd been on the road a long time. He didn't do that all the time. He wasn't dodging. We pulled more than our fair share as a 97th. He was just giving his people a little break. And actually, there was some truth to what he was saying. We were going in non-mission ready status. Unfortunately, there's leaders out there that don't do that, that don't get it, and they will step on your face on their climb to careerism. And I don't think I've ever told you guys this in front of the camera, and this will probably be the last part. I'm going to wrap it up on this one, is that I was actually asked to be the squadron commander of Utah Air National Guard. In 2010, it was a decision I had to make. Nutnfancy projects cranking along, and I really thought about it. I never envisioned myself of, oh, I want to be squadron commander. It's so awesome, you know. It just will fulfill me in my career. I'm not a careerist. I never thought I'd pin on 05, dude. I never thought I'd get that. I was like, oh, lieutenant colonel, me? Are you kidding me? No way. You guys are probably saying that. There's no way. You bought that flight suit somewhere. You bought it at a swap meet, nothing fancy. There's no way you were that. You're too big of a goof, man. Yeah, maybe so. There's a warrior in here, too, though. Maybe you sense that. So I was asked to be squadron commander by my good friend, my operations group commander, who's still in the job currently. And he's like, I'd really, really love you to do this. I mean, you'd be good for the job. And honestly, and this is going to lead me to my next point, and it's don't sweat the nonsense. On my integrity, there's actually a couple reasons I turned down the job, but one of the key reasons is because of my integrity. Because currently in the Air Force, there is a movement towards more political correctness, more nonsense, and actually being part of the reserve components, the Utah Air National Guard, specifically National Guard, the Air National Guard Bureau, there's a movement to make them more like active duty, that they're not autonomous anymore. We don't call the shots for our unit. They just come down with a tasking. They're like, you will do this. You have part-timers, yes, but we're going to send them on 30-day deployments, and no, you don't have a say in it. It might be 60 days, and if you complain about it, we'll activate your unit. You know, there's threats being passed down. So if I were to have accepted the job as squadron commander, now I'm a yes man of sorts. Now I stand up, and I have to deliver all this news coming down to my buddies in my squadron. I go, okay, guess what? We got tasked again. We're going, you know, the Army guys will laugh. They'll say, oh, yeah, 30-day deployment, that's a joke. I'm not talking just 30 days. It's like 60, 90, 120. It just depends on what's going on. It could be much longer. But, you know, some of the guys in the squadron have businesses, and, yeah, they sign on the dotted line. They're reserve component guys. I know. I've heard it all. Been there, traveled the road, done it myself for a decade. I'm empathetic, and my hat goes off to the Army guys that deploy for a long time, and they have all the same things. I know. not saying it's any better or any more important. It's actually probably less important. But to the guys in my squadron, it's not. It's important to them. And so for me to stand up and toe the party line, not just that, but all kinds of other things is, you know, the latest thing that comes down, the fit test, you're going to do this, these are the new things, you know, we don't trust you, we're going to second guess you on this, and just all this nonsense comes down. And, you know, I was guy in the back row bitching about all this stuff. I was. You ask anybody in my squad, they go, yeah, Nutnfancy is like that. He'll just say it. He'll call it. He's like, yeah, that's stupid. Why are we doing it this way? It's dumb. Remember what I said. If it doesn't directly contribute to your warfighting capability, you need to look at it very closely. Maybe you just need to bail on it. You know, for instance, Air Force came down and they have Air Force Blues Wednesdays. I think it's Wednesdays. Maybe it's Blues Mondays. Probably Blues Mondays. I forget. I never did it because I was always flying. When I'm at the unit, I'm working my job. I'm flying. Oh, and by the way, that's busy. I bet you didn't know that for the first 2.5 years of the Nutnfancy project, 2 years, doing this job. I'm going out, flying sorties, and working my civilian job at the same time. So I'm doing that, doing TMP. It was a lot. It was a lot of deploying, supporting the war in Afghanistan. I'm doing on medevac missions to Bagram Air Base, which is amazing. Haul out those poor guys that have been blown up. God, you talk about humbling. Yeah. Went into Bagram, pulled some guys out there, and it's humbling. Doing all that. You know, and then squad commander jobs offered. They're like, hey, you want to do this? And I'm like, well, integrity, I would say no. Because I don't agree with how the Air Force is shoving this stuff down our throats. And I don't feel like I can stand up in good conscience and say, rah, 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 go guys, support this. I don't. And then more importantly, of equal importance is that ability of, if I do squadron commander, I have to shut down TMP. At least for a while. I have to. There's no way I can do both. Because I'm not going to be one of these CS squadron commanders that's absentee, that's not there. He just has the job and title, but he's actually not a part of what's going on, not helping the guys. I would not do it that way. I would not. And that means I'm going to live in the squadron probably 4 days a week. TMP goes bye-bye. And so me and my ops group commander, we had a good talk. He's like, you want to do TMP in the office? He's like, oh, you could, but I prefer you didn't. And I was like, okay, I understand. So in the end, I said no. I turned it down. I said, I'm just going to throw in papers and punch. Been a great ride. Had a great time in the Air Force, but, you know, it just wasn't for me. But it mostly is I don't like the nonsense that's coming down. You know, and I recommend that if you go in the military, I don't care what service you're in, that you fight that nonsense, the political correctness. You know, and it just pervades every part of the Air Force. I mean, everywhere I look, there's a social actions poster. You know, but Nutnfancy, that stuff goes on. Well, kind of, is what I'll say. Kind of. I don't think near to the level where they make it seem like. And I've actually seen it where, here we go, I'm going to speak real honest with you guys. I've actually seen it where that is used as a weapon against some really good troops. We had a chief master sergeant at Minot Air Force Base. And we had a female boom operator there. I won't say names. I don't even remember the names, really. And she was substandard in her job. She was not competent in her job. She was bad. And he was trying to improve her. And he was not a crew member himself. He was actually in charge of the enlisted folks over there. He went to her dorm room because he'd gotten a latest evaluation. And the mistake he did, learn from this, is he didn't go with someone. I know this guy. He was a very squared away troop. He's a good guy. He didn't go there to sexually harass her or anything like that. He went there to give her, read her the riot act. Said, listen, here we go again, this stuff. And so he dressed her down. I don't know if that's the right terminology. He counseled with her in the hallway. He never went in the room. He's like, listen, this is not good. Because he'd been trying, if I get my facts straight, he'd been trying to reach her another way. She was not answering the phone. So he's like, okay, here we go. You suck, basically. What did she do? She turned around and said that he had sexually harassed her and wrote a report. And she used this whole grievance process against that guy. His career was over. Because the Air Force was like, oh yeah, he did. They didn't really investigate it at the time. It was a big blowout at Minot at the time. And this guy's career was over. I say over. He didn't retire immediately, but he lost his position. He was shuffled off into some nonsense job that didn't mean much. And then he retired shortly thereafter. And it was a sad end to a warrior troop. To a guy who's doing the right job. And she was empowered in the process. And so, yeah, sometimes that whole thing can be turned upside down, helter-skelter. It's nonsense. It's political correctness, and I don't agree with it. Most of the guys I know, most of my buddies, don't agree with it. We look at it, we laugh at it. It's not worth saying, well, hey, yeah, sexual harassment should be permitted. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that let guys, you know, just do their jobs. Quit trying to force a social agenda on the military. Hate that. Hate that. That's another reason I was like, I'm done. You know, and I'm going to say, if you decide on a military career, go in with your eyes open. Wide open. It was a privilege to have served in the Air Force. A privilege. I would do it all over again. Things have changed, though. It's not the Air Force of my dad. In the 1970s, it was really wild. I mean, I grew up. I used to go to my dad's office in the 70s, and, you know, there were smoke and ashtrays everywhere. And you could say whatever you want, you know, just laughing, joking, carrying on. His buddies were there. It was just awesome. You know, I was like, this is really cool. I used to meet the C-130 crews coming into base ops and as a kid at Langley Air Force Base and beg their in-flight meals off from. We call them box nasties now. The in-flight meals. But back then, that was cool, man. C-130 guys, hey, man, can I have your food? And they're like, yeah, they're totally cool. Seems like a different Air Force back then. It was, I'm sure a lot of this nonsense still went on. I heard about it from my dad. But it seems like as years gone on, it's more of what I was saying. Going with your eyes wide open in that realm. And then also, depending on your specialty, know what you're getting into. Know what it can ask of you, because it may ask everything of you. You know, if you want to be, you know, in combat infantry, combat arms, armor, know what that's going to entail. Know that you will probably be utilized. And this is a talk I had with my family friend, Tactical Doodles buddy, Invert Smell, USMC. He's in Motor T now, yes. USMC, like in that. Afghanistan as I film this. We're praying he comes back safely, but I told him, I sat down, I was like, know what you're getting into. Motor T is heavily used over there. Totally you not. Are going to do convoys. You are going to get shot at. You may not come back. And the CS thing about this is it's probably not going to be a stand-up fight. It's not like you can go return fire to these guys and have a stand-up fight. It's going to be an IED, and you only know it hits you, and you're dead. You might have an ambush here and there, but still, it's going to be asymmetric. It won't be, a stand-up fight. Know what you're getting into, because depending on what your specialty is, it could ask your life of you. And you could be deployed in a military action you completely disagree with politically. You're like, why are we over here? Why are we doing this? This is messed up. We should have no business being over here. And there's guys that feel that way in those theaters right now. Yeah, are they right? Maybe they are. I ain't going to get into that. It's not germane to what I'm talking about. But you need to go in with eyes wide open. The way you need to do that, and this is what I did, is, well, I grew up in an Air Force family. I grew up with an Air Force dad. So I had it right there. It was convenient for me. I saw it. I saw the fighter world because my dad was a fighter pilot. And so I was in it, I saw it, I talked to the guys. I used to go talk to the F-106 guys, the Delta Dart guys who were sitting on alert at Langley Air Force Base. Way back when up at Hill, I used to go up to F-16 guys, I would talk to them, hey, how do you like it? I was always fishing for information. I was just a sponge. I was like trying to learn and trying to envision if that was the right life for me. That's when I decided I wanted to be, you know, wreak havoc, at least at the time, as a CAS pilot. So I researched it, and I started asking guys about it. And that's who you need to ask. And I'm not just talking about piloting. I'm talking about anything in the military or any job that, and I've said this before on camera, that appeals to you. Go find people who are doing it and find out the pros and find out the cons, because there's always going to be cons. In my job, there are a lot of cons as well. You know, I was deployed. I'd get a phone call in the middle of the night. My first deployment, we're decorating the Christmas tree. 1992, phone call rings, pack your bags, you'll be leaving on a jet. And, well, I don't know, they said like 4 hours. Go through the mobility line. We deployed to go support what was happening down in Somalia, Black Hawk Down. So we went to Lodge's field, Portugal, and we were doing air bridge for the C-141s, hauling in trash in and out of there. Trash, I'm talking like material arms and all the other stuff that was going on. But I was gone for months on end with that deployment, and yeah, it's a downside. Welcome to the military. You sign online, that's what you're going to do. Might be getting shot at. Training is very difficult. You know, and again, my training's easy compared to some other military operations out there. Be Air Force PJ. Talk to those guys. See about their training, how tough it is, their washout rate. Wow. Navy SEAL, same thing. has to be tough because the job is tough. They're trying to prep you. They're trying to find the quality people. They got to weed out the chaff and have the cream of the crop identified. These are the guys that get the job done. The girls in some situations that can get the job done. That's what they need. Talk to those guys. But know the negative parts. You know, UPT was a kick in the face. It sucked. And I was married. I had a little baby. Tactical doodle. You talk about tough. That's tough. Be a dad, be a husband, and do the workload, the academic workload, the flying. You may not pass. You know, difficulty, you know, ear problems, all the stuff I was telling you about. Anything in life that's worthwhile will be that way, though. Anything in life. It's going to be difficult. And when you face that challenge head on, you're not a CS. You're fearful, but like I said, conquer your fear, get your training, attack it, and really apply yourself, put in the work. I'll tell you, it feels so great. It feels so great. It feels fulfillment. You're fulfilled because you did it. I can't tell you how many people I know that have traveled the military route, and they come from very humble families and situations. Some are downright poor. Their mom and dad had no money at all. I have several Air Force buddies like that, and their dad wasn't a pilot. And they're just poor, and they made a success out of themselves in the U.S. military. They became squadron commanders, stand-up guys. I'm talking good guys. My ops group commander's that way. The dude I was talking about, he is such a great dude. Best ops OG I've ever seen. He's just awesome. Great pilot. He's a leader in the plane. People love him. He has a good balance between people and mission. That way. Doesn't matter what economic background you come from for the military. Doesn't matter if you're black, you're white, you're female, you're not female. Doesn't matter. If you're good at your job, you meet the standards, and hopefully you exceed the standards, and you are a warrior in your job. And I don't care what that job is. You're a pilot, great. You're shooting an M249, awesome. Hit your freaking target. You know, you're in finance, awesome. Run your shop well. Have your people respect you. Make the right calls. Take care of your people. Enhance the warfighting capability of your units. Awesome. Be good at your jobs. You'll be successful. You'll get ranked. You'll get rank, and you'll be respected by your subordinates. And that's more important. Because that's what a leader's about. Hey, what do you think about so-and-so? After you talk to whoever you're going to hook up with about the job, find out who his buddies are and go talk. Say, especially if they're a leader, they're a squadron commander. I'm going to the Air Force thing again because that's what I know. Air Force, you know, squadron commander, ops officer. Hey, well, you know, if you can tactfully, what's that guy like? He's a stand-up guy. You know, if they don't know you really good, they're not really going to be honest with you. But maybe you have an inside connection. You can find out. And if you find one of these stand-up guys and listen to him, listen to him. I remember I was in pilot training. I had an awesome instructor in T-38 phase. Again, this is T-38. He was just a great guy. Hubbard was his last name. And he was an F-16 driver in Hahn, Germany. And I asked him, at the time, you know, I'd already made a decision that fighters probably weren't the best track for me because of family, politics, and just culture. I don't know if I would have fit in well. And I asked him about it. I was like, dude, you know, this is me still fishing for information because it wasn't too late to change my mind. And he was an F-16 guy. And at the time, that particular mission had a nuclear mission attached to it. So it was very serious. I mean, these guys, you know, I'll just leave it at that. They had a nuclear mission. And I said, so how is it? Do you enjoy being a fighter pilot? And he goes, you know what? He's like, you know, I don't know if word enjoy is correct because it's so much work. He's like, I lead a four ship on a low level. I transition through all these sectors. I go through French airspace, German, British airspace. I'm talking to controllers. You know, I'm leading a four ship. I'm thinking about my guys, keeping them safe, watching terrain. I'm flying at 400 knots, sometimes 500 knots, just freaking cranking on a low-level route. I have an IP time to make. We have some ground threats we've got to think about. I'm trying to get, you know, targets, you know, in on time, hit my IP time, extract and stay safe, do the mission. It's so much work, I never think about it. I never go, oh, this is cool. And it's only when I'm laying in bed at night, everything's all said and done, I'm exhausted, and I'm looking up at the ceiling, falling asleep, and I go, wow, I guess what I did today is pretty cool. That's what Hubbard told me. And I was like, that is a pretty good description. A pretty good description of what it's like to be, not just a fighter pilot, but I would say a pilot in general in the U.S. Air Force. is that it's a lot of work. At times you're just trying to keep it going. You're trying not to let people down. You're not really, sitting back going, look how awesome I am. You don't have time for that nonsense. Now, some guys do that. Again, we get back to the big talkers, the blowhards, the incompetent posers. That's who they are in some cases, not always. But the guys who are real deal, they're not doing that. They're pulling their weight. They're pulling sometimes more than their weight. And they're just trying not to let people down and be good at their jobs. So yeah, learn about that stuff and just soak it all in. Wow, we've talked about a lot of stuff. That's it. It's going to be a three-parter, dudes. I want to express my gratitude to the United States Air Force. To my buddies I served with. And they'll probably watch this video. It was a privilege to serve beside you. It was a privilege to fly with you. It was a privilege to wear the uniform. It was a privilege for me to wear the rank. It was a privilege for me to have these Air Force wings. I never took it for granted. I never will. I would do it all over again. I did complain about some stuff. I tried to give you a heads up on some stuff that I think you should know about. Go in with eyes wide open. I won't change any of that. It's mostly good. It's mostly good. In some small way, I think I've perhaps paid back my debt of the freedom I inherited. At times I put my life on the line. There's some other stories I haven't told you. And I never thought of it as doing anything other than my job. And it's funny, I was preparing for this video and I was talking to my son, Doodle. And I was like, yeah, did I ever tell you that story about the CJs? And he's like, no. Horrible. I'm very nonchalant about it. I don't. In TMP, I'm that way too. I never came out with my military association. I never wanted to because I didn't want to say, oh yeah, look at me, I'm a military guy. Who cares? Let the information, the adventures that I do here in TMP speak for themselves. I don't want to have to cash in on my military stuff. And there's a lot of guys that do a heck of a lot more than I've ever done. There's guys out there getting their arms blown off, their legs blown off. They're saving their buddies under heavy enemy fire. I'm talking Congressional Medal of Honor winners. That type of bravery. I mean, I just stand in awe of the generation that's serving over there. And I think, my path that I traveled, compared to the sacrifices those kids are making out there, is a joke. It's a joke. I respect the service that all of you do. I have thousands and thousands of military members in all services, and actually in all of our allied nations also serving. They do the same thing. They put their lives on the line. Thank you. Thank you. It's a privilege to stand in this uniform and to have worn it, and I am so grateful for that opportunity. Nutnfancy sign off Air Force Stories.